Hey, you all, Carpetbagger here, coming to you live from the South. More specifically, we are in Scottsboro, Alabama, and even more specifically than that, we're here in front of Unclaimed Baggage, a very unique store here in Scottsboro, Alabama. Now, Unclaimed Baggage is where the airlines send all the luggage, all of the things that are lost by travelers. If your suitcase goes missing, if you leave something on the plane, doesn't have your name on it, it winds up here. And then we go inside, you will see there is a lot of stuff in there. And the first time I came here, I wondered, how does so much stuff get lost? Why does the airlines have so much unclaimed luggage? And I guess there's a variety of reasons. People maybe simply forget. Things get misplaced. I admit, I don't think I put, you know, I'm trying to think. I don't have like a special luggage tag on my luggage. I have like the thing that the little sticker they give you to wrap around the handle. And I actually spoke with someone once that used to work in the luggage department. And I told them, I said, I went to Unclaimed Baggage. There is so much lost luggage. How does this happen? And they explained to me that what happens a lot of times is that people put the tag around the retractable part of the suitcase, and those break off constantly. I've broken them off many a times on my suitcases. So a lot of times people will tie the tag on the retractable part, that breaks off, and then the luggage is unidentifiable. Because of this, I always put it on the actual bag itself, the hard handle that connects to the bag. That's what I always do, ever since I heard that story. But so luggage goes missing. You know, a lot of times it gets misplaced. A lot of times people, file claims against the airline that, you know, their luggage is gone missing. That happened to my sister. I remember she lost a expensive piece of clothing on an airline. And eventually the airline did reimburse her the money. They never found her luggage, but they reimbursed her the money. So once they have paid you for your luggage, I guess technically it belongs to them. They're no longer responsible for getting it back to you once the claim has been paid out. So what is the airline to do with all these extra suitcases packed with luggage? What do? They sell them here in Scottsboro, Alabama, because all the stuff in here, all the stuff that's been left behind, all the stuff that's been separated from its owners is now for sale. So you can go in there and buy someone else's lost goods. In addition to that, they also have a museum on the inside where they have some of the more unusual things that have been lost over the years, some of the more unusual things that have been misplaced over the years. And actually, since the last time I've been here, they've done a complete renovation of their museum. So I'm really excited to see that. So please follow me. I guess the museum is over on this side of the building, but there's actually no outside entrance. You'd have to head in the main door to get to the museum. And here, this is kind of what they use for their logo. This truck here, the Unclaimed Baggage truck, with the piles and piles of vintage suitcases in the back. Now these, I'm trying to see if these are actual. I think these are actual suitcases. I think they've been coated over to protect them from the elements. Yeah, love the big pile of antique luggage there. You're on this beautiful orange truck. And that sign welcoming us, welcome to the Unclaimed Baggage Center. Whether you lose your baggage on a plane, on a bus, or on a train, it's here for other people to buy at the Unclaimed Baggage Center. But without further ado, let's head inside and rummage through strangers' lost possessions. Right here, when you enter the building, you can see like the back of a truck here.
that shows all, again, more of these cool vintage suitcases. Always had to have a thing for like cool vintage luggage. It says the Unclaimed Baggage Journey. So journeys from the airport, the train, the bus, where you leave it, and then winds up getting put in a truck and driving to Alabama. Now they're playing a video here for their Reclaimed for Good program. So not all the stuff that gets brought to the center gets sold. Apparently they do take and sort items and give them to various charities. Yeah, you can see they're like collecting wheelchairs there to make sure they go to the right place. All right, and here we are. You can get your shopping bag here. I got it at Unclaimed Luggage. They also have some of these monster shopping bags here as well. Well, that's a big bag. I'm not gonna need all that. Now, there's a map here that kind of gives us a layout of the store, but and throughout, you know, they have a dedicated museum section, but throughout they have unusual items that have been found in luggage. This is a Hani headdress there. And of course you do see a lot of items that would be in luggage, like you know, clothing, shoes there, lots and lots of sunglasses. And of course, the luggage itself. You know, all this stuff arrived here in suitcases, in bags, and you can purchase the stuff inside. You can also purchase the bags that they came in. The men's shoes section here. I do have some Crocs, but I like to get my Crocs fresh, because don't want the tread to be worn. That's actually got some good tread on it still, admittedly. I don't really like the tie-dye design though. I kind of like to have the solid colors. I do know that like sneakers, sports shoes can be highly collectible. It's a pair of Air Jordans there. These are 145 used. So that must be a nice pair. Here is a 1934 French newspaper was found in someone's luggage. I bet they were really, you know, these things that are more valuable, you know, that people definitely must have been very disappointed. I don't know. I guess if you lose something really valuable, you got to come here to the Unclaimed Baggage Center, look through their museum section to see if it showed up here. There's a bottle of Remy Martin cognac. Says that a bottle of this actually worth $4,000. Wow, $4,000 bottle of cognac there. See these outfits here? These are stage performing outfits. And they said that they verified they were made by Rhett Turner, the designer to the stars, creates stage outfits. Now it doesn't explicitly state it here, but it says it is heavily indicates that they believe that these outfits were intended for Donnie and Marie Osmond, but apparently never made it to the show. Have a luggage photo op here. That's a lot of fun. Apparently you can climb around inside the luggage and poke your head up through the different suitcases. Now these pieces of art here, I guess it is unverified 100% who the artist is, but it is believed that they are painted by Jean Michael Basquiat, who is a painter that has sold his paintings for very large sums of money. So it definitely said it matches his style, although apparently, I don't know, someone should definitely call and ask him if these are his paintings. because it says this painting above, this is a print, not an original. This painting, the original, sold for $110 million. So these here could be worth a pretty penny here. Oh my goodness. Yeah, a lot of clothing here. As you imagine, probably the vast majority of what they get is clothing. Probably makes up the largest portion of luggage. It looks like a lot of cowboys forget their hats on planes. Yeah, I bet someone was super sad when they lost this Rugrats shirt. I just noticed this plane here hanging over the clothing section. Yeah, this is why your mom would always write your name on your clothes before you went to camp. Oh, some poor unfortunate grandpa lost his shirt. Now this shirt says Fallout on it. I know the new Fallout TV show, the gaming company Bethesda there. I actually did watch the first episode of that. I'm not sure if I'm gonna keep watching it, but I did watch the first episode. It says Fallout Crate. Oh, okay, Lootware. So this would have been, this Fallout shirt would have been in a loot crate at some point. It's a pretty cool Graceland shirt. And these aren't that expensive. It's $4 for a Graceland shirt. That's pretty cool. Here's a shirt for the 31st annual Snow Mountain Powwow in 2023 in Las Vegas, Nevada. You can see the turtle there with the city of Las Vegas on its back. You got the high roller Ferris wheel, the Strat right there. I know that's something like a Native American religious belief, like the turtle plays a huge role in like the creation of the earth. A lot of sports gear over here. These are like snow skis, some golf clubs. Yeah, I could just sense the spirit of ruined vacations where they realized that they did not have their golf clubs or their other sporting items after getting off the plane. Oh, these are these cricket bats? It's a lot of different cricket bats. Oh yeah, look at all these swim trunks here. I don't know if I've ever seen so many swim trunks in the same place. A lot of people didn't get to go swimming on vacation. I'm sorry, I'm getting like hung up on the fact that like these were in people's luggage. You know, just think about people showing up without these items at their destination. Oh man, so many iPads here. I guess that's something easy to lose. Easy to lose while you're on a trip. And yeah, I do know that they do like get rid of all the personal information. I think they wipe everything that's electronic so that you know, they don't sell it to someone and then you have their personal info. It's like all these external hard drives here. Oh, look at all those dongles. And it looks like one of the most absolute plentiful items here is
I'll come back to you.
Looks like probably the most common item here, the most plentiful item is, unsurprising, is AirPods. These are just notoriously easy to leave on a plane, to leave behind, and then they wind up here, just buckets and buckets of them here at Unclaimed Baggage. There's a camera section here. I was checking to see if they had any G7Xs, but that does not look like they do. The G7X, hard to come by, so I would definitely pick one up if they had it. This is something I've been bad about forgetting pieces to, is the Rokus. I keep one in my luggage so I can hook it up to the hotel TV. That's definitely easy to leave behind, especially in a hotel room. If you have it set up and you don't notice it when you're checking out. Yeah, just look at all the headphones here. So many headphones. And a lot of cell phones here. Again, makes a lot of sense. Easy to leave a phone on a plane. And apparently these are so popular, you're only allowed to buy two cell phones per visit here. I guess, yeah, probably some pretty good deals. There's a Not sure the iPhone there. I'm not sure what version that is. That's about $500. Yeah, these things are expensive. So imagine getting a good deal here on one. But this here is what I was most excited about seeing, the newly remodeled museum there. Still has the balloons there from the grand opening. In this room, they keep, you know, the strangest, most unusual things that were found in luggage. It says in this suitcase here, there was actually a suitcase packed with ancient Egyptian artifacts. Now it says these were very valuable and were eventually sold at auction, but they have some replicas of what was in the suitcase. There is a sarcophagus mask there, as well as a sarcophagus for a mummified hawk. It's the weird and wonderful section, and they have these replica shrunken heads. These are not actual shrunken heads, these are recreations. But it says that they did have a shrunken head at one point. They said in the 1980s they found a genuine shrunken head in a piece of luggage. They said that they would actually keep it behind the checkout counter because so many guests wanted to see it. And it said that eventually a doctor from Birmingham wanted the shrunken head so bad that he was able to obtain it. So unfortunately, they do not have the shrunken head on display anymore. It's at some doctor's office in Birmingham, Alabama. There is a coin purse there, made from a dried frog. And they do a good job here of kind of talking about the stories behind the individual items, about, you know, when they showed up and kind of the history behind them. There is a basketball signed by Michael Jordan. Yeah, that's, yeah, it's just amazing the value of some of the things that that show up here. A Michael Jordan signed basketball. Now, here is a taxidermy rattlesnake, but it actually explains here that at one point they found a live rattlesnake. As they were unpacking the suitcase, there was a live rattlesnake slithering around inside. Apparently they can't put the live serpent on display, but this taxidermy one in its place. There is a whale vertebrae. Also has a face carved in it. Yeah, some amazing stuff here. A lot of this was not on display before. So this is definitely, I definitely love the updated museum. The vintage items here. Old microscope. Very old telephone. Yeah, just amazing. Amazing stuff here. Think about all this stuff making its way. There is Barbie and Ken jumbo trading cards. Oh, look at this. Look at this old-timey camera here. The old conductor's hat. There's a hand-carved wooden menorah. Some other Jewish items. The Jewish prayer book there. And a shofar, which is kind of like a musical instrument made out of a ram's horn. There is a cowboy hat signed by Gary Sinise. And this is a cowboy hat signed by Muhammad Ali. And it says here that Muhammad Ali's signature is one of the most sought after signatures in the world. I don't know if maybe he didn't do very many. I know the most valuable signature ever in the history of the United States is Button Gwinnett, who is the most obscure person to sign the Declaration of Independence. Also, these are some cowboy boots here, signed by a Tony Dorsett. I guess he is a football player. There's a motorcycle helmet from the Nitro Circus. These are Venetian masquerade masks. It's a Russian gas mask. I guess unusual headgear is the theme here. Including this deep water diving helmet. And then this is a video camera used for deep diving. Some different musical instruments in here. The bagpipes with the full regalia. This is an Ethiopian instrument known as a begena. This is a Egyptian awud. Yes, different stringed instruments from different countries. A Russian domra. And this is a Turkic kamacha. It's a very, very interesting different stringed instruments. Did not even know most of these existed. This is an Afghan rubab. Possibly the most famous item here, the most famous piece of lost luggage, is a dwarf named Hoggle. Yes, Hoggle from Labyrinth, the movie Labyrinth, starring David Bowie. The actual puppet for one of the characters, Hoggle, got lost here. Now, most of the other characters from Labyrinth are at the Center for Puppetry in Atlanta, but Hoggle's over here in Alabama because he got lost in transit, I guess. And I will say, Hoggle looks really good. I guess that's something they did here for the new museum, is they re-sculpted Hoggle's face and hands. They said that when they received him, he was in a very rough, deteriorating state. I know at some point they had tried to do some renovations on Hoggle, and I don't know. They did a good job to keep him preserved, but it kind of changed the way he looked. I don't know. You can't see his face very well from here, but yeah, they definitely covered him with something. Maybe you think he was probably like latex to begin with. So here's the original head and arm of Hoggle, and they've displayed it in a way where you can actually see how the animatronic components work on the inside of his head, or puppet components there. So he was actually a very complicated puppet for the time, but I guess to preserve Hoggle in all his glory, they had a sculptor recreate the head and hands there, and it looks really good. It looks, you know, he looks like he does in the movie. So good to see Hoggle doing well. Kind of the crown jewel of unclaimed baggage here. A few other stray items from Labyrinth as well. But yeah, good to see Hoggle. It says, "Hi, I'm Hoggle." A great movie, Labyrinth. Here's an accurate replica of the HMS Surprise. I guess this is the ship that the movie Master and Commander was based on. And it says here that the ship used in the movie to stand in for this ship is actually at the San Diego Maritime Museum. And I've actually been there, and I have been aboard that ship as well. So yeah, I kind of love when things come full circle. Little section on ancient African and Asian artifacts here. The suit of medieval armor here. It says that over the history of unclaimed baggage, they have found 4 full suits of armor in people's luggage, and two of them are right here. So I really love what they've done here. Really have expanded the museum, really added a lot of context to the items. So yeah, major upgrade here. Really happy to see it. Oh man, look how many wedding dresses they have here. Again, I don't want to seem like I'm being critical of the store here, because I think it's actually great that, you know, this stuff is getting reused, recycled, and not just wasted. But yeah, looking at these wedding dresses, I could just feel the sadness radiating from the brides that arrived for their destination wedding, only to find their wedding dress was nowhere to be found. This is pretty beautiful right here. These are pieces of luggage painted, painted with some lovely images. You got dinosaurs there. This fun little guy and Cal being abducted by an alien. But this is actually really kind of touching. These are a program, Love Luggage, where they actually repaint these suitcases here to give to foster children. Foster children often do have to use suitcases to move from home to home. And this is actually really touching to me. I used to work in CPS, and I can tell you this actually does make a difference.
So I don't do this very often on this channel, but I'm gonna put my social work cap on, back on for just a moment to just point out like how wonderful this is right here. Foster children obviously are constantly being moved. Often they're being moved abruptly. Things happen, middle of the night, foster kid could be getting moved to a different home, being moved out of a home. Kids may need to come into DSS custody in the middle of the night. And unfortunately, there is a practice that was pretty common in CPS, and that is to place the children's possessions in garbage bags. The move is quick. You have to throw them in garbage bags, get them out of there, get them out of the house. And I've seen discussion how that's actually kind of a harmful practice, because when you're throwing their stuff, everything that they care about in this world, and you're shoving it into garbage bags, kind of sends kind of a negative connotation. So, to have these beautiful suitcases, to have these special suitcases that you can put their stuff in, it shows that, they are important, that their stuff is not garbage, that they are not disposable, their stuff is not disposable. It really sends a positive message to these kids that are already in such a bad situation. So yeah, I saw this and I really thought it was something special.
Over the women's clothing here, you can see a fiberglass Tinkerbell up there. And they do have some of their own merchandise here, the Unclaimed Baggage merchandise. This is their 50th anniversary t-shirt. It says, "You'll never know what you'll find. Tribal mask found in 1995. They sell little versions of the truck out front. It says, "This is Hugo the truck." It says the owner, Hugo Owens, had a Chevy truck that he picked up the very first package of Unclaimed Bags in. And don't forget to grab an external battery while you're here. So I don't recall this, but apparently there is a second building called the Bargain Basement. I think we will go check that out. Just gotta head outside and walk across the parking lot here to the Bargain Basement. So let's see what they have here in the Bargain Basement. Okay, so looks in here is stuff that's more heavily discounted stuff, I guess. They get just a ton of clothing, so it makes sense. They have to discount some of it. So while the main building of Unclaimed Baggage is kind of set up like a retail store, this is more of a like thrift shop type vibe. But there's still fun stuff in here. Like, look at this sheep, and look at that Vegas snow globe there. It says $16.95. That might be, I don't know if that's the original retail price, but that's a fun snow globe. I think me and Jen do have one much very similar to this. And oh, look at this, the Dungeon Master clock. I don't know, I should get that for Boogie. This is a Milwaukee Brewer bobblehead. This is Rowdy Tellez. His name's Rowdy. But yeah, the bobblehead there. I don't know much about baseball, but growing up, my dad would take me to the occasional Brewers game growing up in the Milwaukee area. And I think that's the only professional baseball team I've ever seen. Well, obviously I saw who they were playing against, but I've been to see the Brewers a handful of times as a kid. I don't think I've been to any other professional baseball games. And of course, people leave their bathroom bags, their shaving kits, you know, behind. So yeah, here's medication, shaving cream. Is that some lotion? Oh, and there's a random Backstreet Boy Funko Pop back here. They just have these bins here full of like random items. Oh, look at that. That's a souvenir from one of the Madame Tussauds museums. Wonder which one this is. It doesn't say which Madame Tussauds that came from. And right next door to Unclaimed Baggage, you have the Bag Unclaimed. I guess a business that maybe took a little inspiration from their neighbor. So yeah, great to see Unclaimed Baggage really thriving. The new museum was great. Love how they touched it up and added, you know, they added more artifacts, they added, you know, better explanations on what stuff was, the story behind it. And yeah, just like I said, I always get a kick out of seeing all the stuff that is lost from travel. Obviously, you know, it's great that they're there to help redistribute it, help find new homes for the stuff, even if it does still boggle my mind how much stuff gets lost. But I guess if you take in all the lost luggage all across the country and you know, siphon it down, I guess it makes sense that there's a lot there. But I'm gonna be headed towards the Atlanta area. Got some stuff coming up tomorrow, hopefully, and I'm gonna maybe spend a day or two in Atlanta before I make a pit stop at home. So let's get back on that long, lonesome road. Got this teeny tiny cinema here, a movie theater. It looks like it is closed down, but I just, yeah. Sometimes you see the movie theaters like this tiny. It's got two screens. It almost makes you wonder, like, where they put the screens? This building is so small, it doesn't seem like there'd be room for a movie theater screen inside. So I stopped off here in Rome, Georgia, where I thought we'd get a little dinner here at Sam's Burger Deli. As you can see, a building built out of a plane. Look what they have out here in front. It's a VW bus converted into a plane. Seems like that would be able to go on some very magical flights. You can see not only does it have the wings installed there, but its tires actually have been replaced with propellers as well. That is a lot of fun. See over here on the side of the building, there is a second plane. But enter here over the Armucci Bell, is what it says there on the side. Oh, if you look at these railings here, these are actually, I guess, the wings of the Armucci Bell set here next to the entrance. So let's head in. Oh yeah, you see the landing gear over here. And as we enter here, you can see the bottom of the plane extending into the restaurant. So the counter here also looks like it's made out of plane wings. This is pretty interesting. Here, as you enter the dining room, you can see the walls are just covered in different photos of people that served in the military. You can see this guy here saved this guy's life. See here on the menu, looks like one of their specialties is a meat and vegetable plates. And of course, you know, they're called the Burger Deli. They do have some burgers as well, the Sam Burger. Started off with a
Georgia specialty, some Brunswick stew.
Some Brunswick stew. Very thick, meaty there. Very good. Yeah, it's like really thick, meaty stew, different kinds of meat. Then there's like usually like beans and corn in there as well. Very good.
All right, so I went with the meat and vegetable plate. I got the smoked meatloaf, as well as some collard greens and green beans. Whenever I get the collard greens, I like to add the vinegar pepper sauce to it. Oh yeah. Alright, let's try some of this meatloaf here. It's smoked meatloaf. Very good. There's almost like a little spiciness to it. That's some of the best meatloaf I've had. That is really good. I like that a lot. Green beans. And let's try these collards. Oh, one of my favorite things. Collards with the pepper vinegar sauce. One of my all-time favorite things. And yeah, that is a very good meatloaf.
Yeah, it was called smoked meatloaf, but actually it's really spicy. It has quite a bit of spiciness to it, which I really like. Almost more like a Cajun meatloaf.
Yeah, that is so yummy.
Stopped off here in Marietta, Georgia, because there's one thing I can't do, and that's pass through Marietta, Georgia without saying hello to the Big Chicken. There it is, probably the most unique KFC in the world, the giant towering animated chicken there here in Marietta, Georgia. See it all illuminated at night, squawking out onto the long, lonesome road. This actually originally was not a KFC. It was a different restaurant, but eventually KFC moved in, and it remains a KFC to this day. Wow, look at that eye go in circles. Of course, already ate dinner, but we can take a peek inside. You can see these wooden spoons for doorknobs. The Colonel here hanging out inside of the Big Chicken. He's got a big bucket of fried chicken right there. You can see artwork on the walls depicting the Big Chicken. What's this hiding over in the corner? It's a little Big Chicken. Well, I think this is actually a Big Chicken costume. You can see there's like a vent for breathing. So I guess this is actually a Big Chicken costume that someone can wear. Lots of pictures of the Colonel in here. But we also have a picture of Hubert Puckett, who was the architect of the Big Chicken. Big Chicken has its own merch section here, and I really like this shirt, but yeah, it looks like they only have it in XL, don't have a 2X, but yeah, all these shirts are pretty cool. They also have Big Chicken socks. They also have some hats.
and some pins and a magnet there.
Yeah, it said here in Marietta, Georgia, when anyone's giving you directions, all the directions tell you how to get to a place from the Big Chicken. The Big Chicken is basically the ultimate reference point here in Marietta. And it's very striking as you drive by on the road and you see this towering moving chicken here.
All right, well, I'm not far from my hotel for the evening. Gonna get in and get a little rest and then wake up and do it all again tomorrow morning. Thank you so much for sticking with me on these adventures. Big thank you to anyone who watches these videos, and an extra thank you to those who actually watch every day. That means a lot to me. And you know, if you're new here, I travel around the country. I film roadside attractions, amusement parks, museums, haunted houses, and other fun random stuff. If you like this, if you like these videos, please subscribe. It does help me out. You hit the subscribe button, you give it a thumbs up, you ring the bell, whatever it takes. And of course, if you want other ways to help support this channel, consider contributing to Patreon. $3 or more get you a postcard once a month from me to you. Also selling enamel pins in the Etsy shop and doing personalized messages on Cameo. Of course, all those things help keep this train on the track, this boat in the water, and this dirigible in the air. Till next time, my friends, this one's in the bag.